Notre Dame Cathedral. It was here that RKO Studios sent a team of sound technicians to record the cathedral's bells as they ring through Paris. The actual bells of Notre Dame are heard in the 1939 production of Victor Hugo's The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Studio chief George J. Schaefer decided that this new version of the classic medieval tale would be better even than the well-regarded 1923 silent version starring Lon Chaney. And one of the things that would accomplish this would be sound. The Hunchback of Notre Dame marked the American film debut of Maureen O'Hara. The Irish-born actress recalls working with legendary producer Pandro S. Berman and director William Dieterle.
My mother was with me, and the next day we had to go to RKO Studios. And I was supposed to say that I was to see Mr. William Dieterle. And of course, as they did in those days, they sent a car. But when we got to the gates of the studio, you're never let in with a car unless you have a pass, and the policeman at the gate knows. Well, obviously, something was wrong and something slipped up. We had no pass, and I couldn't remember William Dieterle's name. And so we sat there, and the policeman said, sorry, no way, because they think you're crashing the studio. We were not going to be let in. And you reach a point where you don't know what to do. You're almost desperate. And my mother was with me. And at that moment, Pandro Berman happened to walk by, but I didn't know who he was. And he recognized this girl he had signed to be in The Hunchback of Notre Dame, and he brought me into the studio.
In many ways, it was William Dieterle, with his training in German Expressionism, who was responsible for the moodiness of Hunchback. The tremendous outdoor sets for Hunchback were constructed at the 88-acre RKO Ranch. Imagine a 15-acre recreation of 15th-century Paris built in the San Fernando Valley in 100-degree summer heat. Studio publicity held that the design for Paris came directly from a 400-year-old wood carving of the city and from Victor Hugo's own descriptions.
They were all sets. We didn't go on location to Paris. They were all built out of the RKO Ranch, and they were magnificent in every detail. When I first saw them, I was astounded. There was little streets, back streets, then the cathedral was magnificent. And at that time, I had never been to Paris. And many, many, many years later, many years, I went to Paris and, of course, went to look at the cathedral and all the surrounding streets and everything else. And I was astounded at how the set at RKO, way out in the valley, was absolutely a perfect replica. It was magnificent, 100% perfect.
The replica of Notre Dame itself cost over $250,000 to build. And in its construction, the studio also claimed to have employed the one thing left from the set of Lon Chaney's version, the cathedral's huge iron doors. At the center of all this activity was the cast. The star of the picture, Charles Laughton, had picked Hunchback to be his first picture under a new contract with RKO. Of course, Laughton had a very definite idea who Pandro Berman should cast as Esmeralda.
I was under contract to Charles and Eric Palmer, and they came to America to make The Hunchback of Notre Dame. So I came along as baggage. Mr. Laughton insisted, and Eric Palmer insisted, that I played Esmeralda. I arrived and went right into wardrobe and right into the movie.
Who is she? What's her name?
Esmeralda.
Esmeralda.
And the rest of the cast was filled in. Edmund O'Brien, a former member of Orson Welles' Mercury Theater, was brought by Berman from the New York stage.
The Hunchback was Eddie's first film, and naturally his first film for RKO Studio. And I never made another film with him, but we were great friends for many, many, many years.
There was also Thomas Mitchell and Harry Davenport. Both had also appeared that same year in Gone with the Wind.
Doesn't she make your pulse beat faster?
William Dieterle's skill in directing huge masses of people is evident throughout the picture.
Well, he was very famous for his crowd scenes, and this was his first film for RKO Studios. And perhaps I think, the most memorable film of his career and life. And people talk about the magnificent crowd scenes in the picture and how he handled the crowds. And a little side note about Dieterle. Dieterle always wore white gloves. And I never, ever figured it out. I didn't know whether the white gloves were that he was afraid of infection, or whether when he directed his great scenes with the extras, whether it was so that his directions were visible to all of them, no matter how far away they were, because his gloves were pure white.
There were hundreds of extras, each needing to be made up, costumed, and fed every day for weeks.
They were wonderful and magnificently dressed. And of course, they had to have one very large tent, which would be the wardrobe tent, where the extras came to pick up their costumes and get dressed.
It was in 1934 that MGM's Irving Thalberg first suggested to Charles Laughton that he should play the deaf hunchback Quasimodo. 5 years later, Laughton had returned from England to finally play the role it now seems he was born to portray.
By unanimous vote, we now proclaim you King of Fools.
Laughton went right to work on his character, starting first with Quasimodo's physical deformities. For this, he insisted that RKO borrow Perse Westmore from Warner Brothers. Westmore's services for this one picture reportedly cost the studio $10,000. But Westmore had a difficult time pleasing Laughton in coming up with the right look for the hunchback.
There are many tests, many trials. They tested many, many times. Perse Westmore was one of the number one makeup men in Hollywood. So it would be understandable that he would be chosen to do the masks and all the design of the whole makeup for Charles. But naturally, it would have been in cooperation and discussion with Charles. So you have to give Charles the credit for saying, I would like, or I want, or I want to look like this, or I want to be able to do that. So it was a cooperation between Charles and Perse Westmore.
The disguise consisted of a false eye and a contact lens, false teeth, earplugs to make sure that Laughton himself was really deaf, and pounds of latex and makeup.
And it was a terrible chore to have that done every morning. You know, he had to start at about 3 o'clock in the morning and then work all day in that dreadful heat in the month of, mostly in the month of August, out in the valley on the RKO ranch. And then, worse still, is at night when you're dead and you're worn out and you're hot and you're sticky, it all has to be taken off. And then the poor makeup man has to clean it and prepare it to put back on again in the morning. That's the horrible part of that kind of makeup, but that's what an actor does.
RKO publicity would not allow any photos of Laughton in his makeup, and none of the movie's poster art or advertising would show the face of the hunchback either, so that audiences would be surprised when they saw the picture.
I couldn't believe it. It was so magnificent and so wonderful. And the way he limped and they shortened his leg was absolutely incredible. And incredible to watch him work.
However, Laughton wasn't the only man on the set to wear the now famous makeup.
Well, Sailor Vincent and Dick Crockett were the two stunt men who at different periods of the pictures did some of the very dangerous things for Charles. And I did two tremendous stunts in the film with them. That was the swing when he came down on the rope and took me from the where I was going to be hanged and swung me back up again. I did that, and that was Sailor Vincent. And after we were up in the cathedral and Quasimodo held Esmeralda up to the crowd to show that she was safe. That was Dick Crockett. And Dick Crockett held me up. And afterwards I looked and there wasn't even a board, there was nothing in front. So if Dick's arm had wiggled or squiggled, I would have fallen hundreds of feet down and been killed. So I learned Well, ever since that, I've always trusted the stuntmen.
The Hunchback of Notre Dame premiered on December 31st, 1939 at Radio City Music Hall, RKO's last release of the year and of the decade. It was also one of the studio's most successful. Although Hunchback cost over $1.8 million, its initial release brought in over $3 million. And in one of the biggest and best years in Hollywood history, Hunchback brought RKO the kind of recognition which George Schaefer had intended.
Variety gave it a fabulous review. The Reporter gave it a fabulous review. And in fact, in the Variety, they gave me a wonderful review and said that I would go far. It's the best Hunchback that was ever made. It's the finest performance by anybody of Quasimodo. And I'm very proud to have been part of it.
The Hunchback of Notre Dame was nominated for two Academy Awards. Alfred Newman for Best Score, and sound technician John Alberg was nominated for Best Sound. Apparently, the studio's trip to Paris had paid off.
The Hunchback of Notre Dame turned out to be one of the great classics of the world. It's renowned all over the world, and magnificent photography, magnificent set dressing, and, of course, magnificent Charles Laughton.
In the end, the film's blending of sanctity and politics, enlightenment and medievalism, extreme cruelty and tender understanding have made The Hunchback of Notre Dame one of the true classics of the studio era.
Why was I not made of stone like thee?